So, you know, you'd like to go in and you'd like to say, I watched some sort of R-rated movie, something you weren't supposed to watch. So younger kids will watch older films, but older kids will watch young will not watch younger films. So the idea that a demographic could be so far-reaching is ludicrous, and it's not an answer. The answer is there's a ripple, and you can explain it, but you have to explain it. It has to be much tighter than that, because somebody will look at your script and your idea and tell you what your demographic is. So you might as well know. Incredibles is one of the films that I think has a broader demographic. I have a little clip from this, again with no sound, but I will at least play it because it'll remind you of the four lead characters. Well, essentially it's his movie about redundancy. The suit that he can't fit into is actually the suit he got married in. This is about growing old and society no longer needing you, right? That's the core challenge of this movie. He's no longer wanted. It's a marvelous setup. But what we love about this movie and why it struck and did reach such a broad demographic and rippled, made that water really ripple, is that each of the family members are superheroes and they all have skills. So the little girl's has got a skill, the little boy's got a skill, and the mum has a skill. So you've got a family of superheroes, always something interesting. So it was a wonderfully broad demographic, but I'd still say it was in a family. And so that was an example of a film that crossed over beautifully, albeit as its core subject matter, something much more interesting than the idea of the actual plot of the movie, which I can hardly remember the plot, right? But something dastardly happens, which she has to come back from retirement to save the day. But the real core of the story is his coming back out of retirement, coming to terms with who he is and the fact he's growing older. And of course, this is the whole thing here. You see, I went this week, oh God, these jeans are a bit tight, you know, because I'm just eating too much, you know. I'm traveling, eating too much, love Indian food, and eating too much. You start to get, when you're young, you can eat all you like, you can drink all the beer you like, and nothing happens, and then suddenly, whoop, you know, what happened? And this film is about whoop, what happened, and what society does when people are not wanted. And we're certainly seeing that in the world today, and we have been seeing the last few years, this idea, get to 40 and watch out. Can be very, very challenging for people. You know, as a pitch, you might want to know what your budget and schedule is. I think pitches and really are the opportunity, and then whatever you have, you have. If it's just the idea and you're ready to pitch it, you pitch it. You don't have to have a whole package, but you might have a budget and schedule. But it's the and that I wanted to draw your attention to, because I think when we pitch, we want to do the pitch that we did when we were lying in the bath, when we were just practicing it, when it all was marvelous, and then when we know we're in the room, we deal with the nerves. I have a particular theory about nerves. If I'm not a little bit nervous when I do one of these, I tell myself that I might not be quite on it. And you need to be on it, and I think nerves drive that. I think athletes will tell you that. I think actors will tell you that. Comedians will tell you. You need that because it's adrenaline. And if you can harness it, you can channel it. And you can channel it to very real, spectacular energy. So in a pitch, you've got that moment. This is your moment. Okay, somebody will say to you, as they've said it to me, what do you got? You sit down in a room, no small talk. You sit down, someone says, okay, what do you got? But what you want to make sure is if you're showing on a laptop, your laptop is already open, the program is open, and you're ready with the first slide. Don't say, oh, hang on a second, I gotta do this, and where's that program, right? Assume you're ready, and you go for it. And when your own mind, you just want to get through it having done a great pitch. I don't think that's the act. This is the act. You want this question at the end of the pitch. You want to hear this big old Hollywood executive saying, what do you want? And also, it's an answer you need to have ready, but I think it's a state of mind for you. You go into these pitches and naturally, you just don't want to screw up. You want to do a great pitch. But what you really want is somebody to say to you, what do you want? What's the goal? You want to sell the project. You want to come, you want to say, speak to my agent. That's the best line, right? Call my agent. But it's that idea of focusing on the goal and not throwing up, not screwing up, because that's really, that's what's crossing our minds, right? Oh my gosh, you know, oh, did this could go wrong, or, you know, I just want to get through it and do a good job. And then once I finish, I go, oh, I've finished. No, you haven't. That's the beginning. Or that's probably act, that's the end of act two. Act three is what do you want, right? Act one was walking in, setting up, shaking the hand. Act two is the pitch, and act three is the conversation, which is another reason you want to leave plenty of time, because the conversation is really the minutes after the pitch when you've done a spectacular job, and there you want to use, you've got 3 minutes, 4 minutes, you want that person saying, what do you want? And that's the thing that I impress upon everybody. Think about that. I think it helps focus a lot. And don't forget, the person you're pitching to has heard hundreds of pitches, thousands of pitches. They know what it is, and they also understand what you're going through too. And those people have probably pitched as well. And another thing to remember is the person you're pitching to is probably going to have to pitch your idea to somebody else. So the simpler and easier it is for them to grasp it, the better too, because they're going to go to their boss and say, I just heard this fantastic pitch. It's really clever, you've got to hear it. And what's that person going to say to you? He's not going to say, oh good, send them over. He's going to say to you, yeah, okay, what's it about? And you're going to have to pitch it. So you want to keep this conciseness running all the way down the line. So what have I got here? What to leave behind? Well, you could leave any or all of these things behind. Screenplay, budget and schedule, design package, you know, for us in animation, you know, the animation test, hard copies, and of course, soft copies. And I think that's the other thing for us nowadays, having those little sticks, right? A little USB stick with your whole presentation on it in the elevator with Steven Spielberg. Hey, have my movie. Take it. You know, I know there's all the confidential issues you have, the NDAs, the submission agreements, and there are all sorts of barriers to pitching and getting in the door. But they're barriers that other people have. They're not your barriers. Your barriers is just to be ready. And you can have things in your back pocket and always, always, always be ready. And that is the secret of that. But yeah, have all of this. This can all be on the stick as well. And I think particularly with animation, we are, you know, when you pitch live action, you often, you know, hear people talk about the actor. Think this actor or that actor or a way of giving you reference points. That's harder for me. Think bunny rabbit, right? Think monkey, tiger, I'm just trying to think of all the animals, parrot, you know, in Delhi Safari. Well, I'm pitching Delhi Safari, a tiger's a tiger. But if I say Tom Cruise, Tom Cruise is Tom Cruise. So sometimes having images of those characters can be very useful. Points of reference. But even if you haven't got points of reference, you could still have points of character traits. Even when you're pitching animation, you can still talk about actors because the personality traits of certain actors, you can use those reference points. But anyway, that's some of the leave behind ideas. You know, the elevator pitch. Always be ready. You never know. Not as many tall buildings in Goa that I've been in so far, but you are, you know. But you know, the beer tent out here, right? Somebody just dropped a beer on your foot, or you spilled some food down somebody else, and you're mopping them up, and you know, suddenly you're in a conversation. You go, hey, what are you doing here? You all have those conversations. Oh, I've got a movie on. Oh, really? And you know, you're up and running, and you don't know which one's pitching who, right? They're pitching you and you're pitching them. You've no idea, but you're sort of ready. You're feeling it out, right? You're putting your bait in the wood. Just what's going on here? Movie titles. Don't underestimate the power of the movie title. How am I doing on time, by the way? Because I'm very conscious that people might sweep in for the next movie. These are the movie titles for last year's Academy Award. Animation is fantastic for the Oscar. There's an Oscar for the best animated film. Live action. At least 300 films are vying for the one Oscar. But there are other titles that I bring your attention, particularly to this film, these two films I'm going to talk about in a second, which I think had very challenging titles. One was a failure, and one was a very successful movie. But they caused enormous challenges to the marketing department. This one, the length of the title, Legends and Guardians, didn't say anything. And I see a lot of titles of Indian movies being pictured in animation that tend to talk about mythology and legends and adventures of somebody. I think they don't tell me anything. And I think this was a real howler of a title. Now, you can get long titles that become fascinating, and they become fascinating because they are titles that are long and you can't pronounce. But a very dangerous territory. The Legends of the Guardians, the Owls of Garhuli. Now, this is the same group, I think, that made Happy Feet, right? So they had a lot of power. They've just made a hit movie. But, and they probably all got a bit sort of like, no, it's the title, it's the title. Well, I think this caused a real problems, not least of which on the billboards, you know, you didn't know what it was. It was very challenging, and now I believe that we go to see movies because of word of mouth. We have initial marketing campaigns, and then we tell each other if a movie's good. That's how we really communicate. But it didn't help. This is the other movie with an amazing challenge. And they overcame this to create an absolutely monster hit movie. Despicable Me, Pedophile, right? There's an older man with three young children, and he's called Despicable Me. The marketing department didn't know what to do with this. This was their solution. The movie suddenly became despicable. The me disappeared, he disappeared, the kids disappeared, and what's despicable? All these little cute characters. And that's how they overcame. They spent a lot of money. This is a huge P&A spend, this movie. $80 million to open this movie. It's a wonderful film. I'm using it because I love the movie. But that was a challenging title for them. So just, you know, I just said, just be aware. Make your title work for you, because really it's your log line. It's part of your sales pitch. Here's the Oscar films for this year, actually. They've just been announced. These are there are 18 movies that can be considered for the Academy Award for this year. So again, the odds are spectacular, right? So next year, Delhi Safari will be on this list. Because to be eligible for an Academy Award, you just have to screen your movie in a minimum number of screens in Los Angeles County. You go and rent your own theater. So it's not about the Academy saying, Delhi Safari, I've never heard of it. No, you are eligible. And your film, to be nominated for the Oscar for Best Animated Film, has to be seen by the branch of the Academy. And the members of that branch, which that's my branch of the Academy, about 400 or 500 members, and if I want to vote for the nominees, I have to attend 80% of the screenings. So this year I'm traveling, so I'm not going to see them, so I won't be voting this year. So you have a very, very good chance. But anyway, these are the films. But look at titles, and just what's great about independent filmmaking. Well, Tintin's up there. This is very controversial within the animation industry, because we're not sure this is animation, right? This is this hybrid crossover, big debate about what's animation. Obviously, you know, more adult-themed film, independent, sequel, Arthur Christmas, Romeo and Juliet, Chico and Rito, another wonderful little independent movie, Cat in Paris, same, Cars 2, lots of sequels in this past year. Happy Feet 2, Hoodwink 2, little note on Hoodwink 2, marvellous first film. It's one of the great movies to study for independent animated filmmakers. For $50 million budget, gross $50 million domestic in the States, but they were too slow coming out with the sequel, 6 years or something. And because the kids who saw the movie and loved the first one were now teenagers, not interested. Kung Fu Panda 2, this is the other controversial film this year, because is it animation or not? Puss in Boots. But again, look at the movie titles, and this is an independent film, it's actually called Wrinkles. I believe that's its whatever title, whatever language that is. That's the only poster I could find of that one. Yeah, these are the two controversial films. A big debate. Is this animation or isn't it animation? But we could spend an entire afternoon just talking about that. But of course, that's about threat to the animators and where does animation come from. But it's also what a great debate to be having, you know, really about all these technologies that are happening. Still the same issue, though. It's all about story. So, logline. You know, the one sentence summary of the project. Here's a famous one. Tricked into thinking he killed his father, a guilt-ridden lion cub flees into exile and abandons his identity as the future king. Lo and behold, it's the Lion King, surprise, surprise. And what's really lovely at the moment, when people say, have you got a film out at the moment? I go, yeah, it's the Lion King.